Recorded Books and RB Digital present Ghosts of Greenglass House by Kate Milford. Narrated by Chris Henry Coffey. Chapter 1. Frost. Frost was pretty much the worst. It was like a promise with nothing behind it. It was like not enough icing on a cookie, not enough butter on toast. It was like the big gilt-framed antique mirror in his parents' bedroom. From a distance, it was shiny and beautiful, but once you got close enough, you could see the plain old everyday wood peeking through the gold paint. Frost, at least when you wanted snow, was about as disappointing as anything in this world had a right to be. Assuming you figured things had a right to be disappointing. Milo Pine wasn't feeling that generous at the moment. He knelt and leaned on the sill of one of the house's two big bow windows, examining the yard critically through a circle of clear glass in the middle of one white-rimed pane. An English Mandarin dictionary and a notebook lay forgotten by one knee. Admittedly, the current spectacle was pretty impressive. The frost perfectly mimicked a dusting of snow, and because the temperature outside was so frigid, it had lasted through the day. It had crunched satisfyingly underfoot, too, which was a nice compliment to the clouds that had puffed into the air with each breath as he crossed the lawn after his last day of school, headed back to the big old inn he and his parents called home. But it wasn't snow, which made it almost worse than nothing at all. This was good. Being cranky about the weather was just what he needed to keep from thinking about the other things he didn't want to let up from the mental depths at which he could just barely manage to ignore them. His mom sat down in the love seat behind him and held out a steaming cup. "You want to talk about it?" "I hate frost," Milo said in a tone that he hoped would signal to his mother to please not dare to suggest that the weather wasn't what was really bothering him. Twilight was coming on, and he could sort of see her reflection in the glass. She had a look on her face that was both unimpressed and thoughtful, as if she had gotten the message and was debating whether or not to call him on it. But then, the glass was old, wavy, and uneven, so maybe it was just twisting up her reflection funny. He reached back to take the cup. On top of the hot chocolate was a float of unreasonably thick whipped cream that he'd heard Mrs. Caraway, the inn's cook, making about 10 minutes ago. The cream was dusted with smashed candy cane bits, which was probably his mother's touch. He hazarded a look at her. She definitely knew he was upset about something other than weather. She was just waiting him out. Well, he could play that game too. "Thanks," he said, and turned resolutely back to the window. "First hot chocolate of winter vacation," Mrs. Pine raised her own cup. "Cheers." "Cheers." As they sipped, footsteps approached on the stairs. Reluctantly, Milo pivoted to look over his mom's shoulder, following the sound. The ground level of the inn was big and open, with one room flowing into the next, and from where he was, Milo could see pretty much the entire floor. "When's he leaving?" he asked, watching the bottom of the staircase on the other side of the dining room. "Tomorrow at some point, supposedly," Mrs. Pine said quietly. Then she turned to the young man who appeared at the bottom of the stairs, a pencil behind one ear and glasses askew on his nose. "Drinks on the stove if you're done for the day, Mr. Sybuck." Emmett Sybuck, their only guest, sighed happily. "I could just stay here forever. This place is amazing." "Well, we're so glad you've enjoyed your visit. Hey, about that, Mrs. P." "Oh, no." Milo stifled a groan. His mom patted his shoulder. The young man crossed the dining room and came to lean on the back of the love seat. "I was thinking," he said, "one more day and I'll have every window at least sketched. Would it be a huge pain in the neck if I checked out day after tomorrow?" Milo slurped in a huge mouthful to keep himself from answering. Yes. Yes, it would, actually. I personally would find it a huge pain in the neck. His mother, of course, said what Milo had known she'd say. Oh, that's no problem, Mr. Cybuck. Their guest beamed. Thanks, ma'am, and I wish you all would just call me Emmett. You're welcome, and I'll try, Emmett. But, you know, old habits die hard. Mrs. Pine glanced into the kitchen. Mrs. Caraway leaves tonight, though, so just be aware that meals will be a little less fancy tomorrow. It could be toast and instant noodle soup, and I'd be perfectly content, Emmett assured her. I'm a simple fellow at heart, and in a pinch, some of my colored pencils are kind of tasty. Not that I've tried them or anything. Milo's mother laughed. It won't come to that. Well, thanks again. And hey, thank you too, Milo. Milo turned, surprised. What for? For letting me impose on your holidays. I promise I'll be out of your hair before Christmas Eve. I know how it is. It's okay, Milo said gruffly. Well, I appreciate it. And now that I don't have to pack tonight, I think I'll relax and just stare at the fire a while. He drummed a short bada-ba-bump on the back of the love seat with his palms, then straightened and went into the kitchen. You think he's really an art student? Mrs. Pine asked in an undertone. Probably, Milo said. That, or he's Skellinson in disguise, wanting to make sure his precious chandelier's being looked after properly. They'd been amusing themselves with speculations like this since the day Emmett had showed up. He's too young for Skellinson. Milo eyed the guest's back critically. Lots of makeup and super thin rubber prosthetics like in the movies. You can do miracles with that stuff. Maybe. Among the many occurrences that had made last year's winter break about the strangest time in Milo's life was the discovery at Greenglass House of a cartoon, a valuable drawing of a stained glass window by a mysterious artist named Lowell Skellinson. One of the inn's guests at the time, Dr. Wilbur Gowervine, had presented the cartoon along with a lecture at Nagsbeek's City University over the summer. A couple of months after that, Emmett Cybuck, student, artist, and Skellinson fanboy, had turned up toting enough art and photography supplies to open a store, eager to learn more about the house and its collection of stained glass. It wasn't Dr. Gowervine's fault. After much discussion with Milo's parents, he'd promised to keep the location of the find between himself and his department chair. Still, when you took into account that not only Dr. Gowervine, but five other guests had made their way to the inn last December by following different bits of the house's history to its doorstep, maybe the only surprising thing was that more curiosity seekers hadn't worked out where the mysterious Skellinson artwork had come from. Not that the Pines had admitted to anything when Emmett had turned up, other than to confirm that, yes, they had also attended the lecture, and yes, they suspected that the chandelier over the dining room table was a piece of Skellinson glass. But that had been enough for Emmett. The guy acted like a kid on Christmas morning, every single day, and he'd been here a week already. Of course, the other notable thing about last year was that none of the strangers who'd come to the inn that Christmas had been there for the reasons they'd claimed they were. Hence the "Is Cybuck who he says he is?" game, even though Milo was pretty sure that was all it was, a game. And really, Emmett's presence was fine, as long as he did what he said he would and got the heck out before Christmas Eve. The door swung open, letting in a gust of wind, but naturally, no accompanying swirl of snow. Stupid frost. Didn't even blow around in the wind. Instead, the gust swept Milo's father inside with an armful of firewood. Mrs. Pine got up. Ben, Mr. Cybuck, Emmett, is going to stay on an extra night. If that's okay, Emmett called from the kitchen, where Mrs. Carraway was busy ladling hot chocolate into his mug. Not a problem, Mr. Pine called back as he kicked off his boots on his way to the fireplace. Mrs. Carraway joined Milo's parents in the living room. Nora, Ben, you guys want me to stay an extra night too? No, no, Mrs. Pine said immediately. Isn't Lizzie already coming to pick you up? Probably, but she was out running errands anyway. I don't think she'll mind having made the trip. I might invite her to stay for dinner. Of course. Mrs. Carraway turned to Milo. Any requests? Grilled cheese and tomato soup? I have chili fixins. She glanced at the dictionary on the floor. Or I have some surprisingly good tomatoes that would be amazing in the egg and tomato stir-fry dish you like, whose name I always mangle. Shi Hong Shur, Chao Ji Dan, Milo said promptly. There weren't a ton of Chinese dishes he confidently knew the names of, but this one he'd made sure to memorize. Yes, please, and maybe grilled cheese, too? It wasn't the kind of dinner she usually made when there were guests, but then Milo didn't usually get asked for his input. Grilled cheese is my actual favorite sandwich, Emmett said as he dropped contentedly onto the sofa in the living room. And I'm generally a fan of tomatoes and eggs. This is great. Well, good. Milo dropped his chin into his hands, waiting for that special relief that usually came with getting home from school at the start of vacation. It hadn't come yet, and the more he looked for it, the further away it seemed. Instead, he was tense and tight and frustrated and angry, and he wasn't sure whether it was Emmett's presence that was keeping him from feeling good or all the other stuff. Unfortunately, that uncertainty made all those worries he'd tried to cover with a layer of disappointing frost come bubbling back up. You don't have to feel this way, he told himself. Negret wouldn't feel this way. It didn't help, not even remotely. That was maybe the most frustrating thing of all. His father sat down on the floor next to him. Hey, pal. Hey. So, your mom said when you first got home, you mentioned that something happened at school today. It was yesterday, and I just didn't want to talk about it. Still don't, he added silently. Do you... His father stopped mid-question and shifted gears. Was it social studies again? Milo scowled at the window and nodded stiffly. His father started to speak, paused, then said, I think if you could tell me what happened so Mom and I can talk to the teacher, it's possible you might feel a little better. Why? Milo asked. It won't change that it happened. That's true, but would any part of you feel better knowing it won't happen again? You don't know that, Milo grumbled. Even if you and Mom talk to him, you don't know that. I submit that it's worth a shot, Mr. Pine said. If we don't try, then we can be almost sure it will happen again, don't you think? Or did you explain to him afterward, like you said you would last time he upset you? No, Milo admitted in a very small voice. Wasn't that our agreement, though? His dad asked gently. You said you didn't need Mom and me to do it because you wanted to try yourself. Milo nodded. Mr. Pine nodded too. Okay, well, how about this? How about we just start with you telling me what happened so you can get it off your chest? Getting it off your chest never did any good. That was a parent thing, thinking that talking about stuff helped. And why did no one understand this? Nothing could change that the awful thing had already happened. That was why you felt crummy afterward, obviously, because it happened, not because you needed to talk about it and live through it all over again. But Milo didn't have any better ideas, and his dad didn't look as if he was going to leave. All right, he took a deep breath. We're still studying Neg-speak history in the 19th century. I remember. Well, I guess after I said the thing last week about how our house was built during the War of 1812, and Mr. Chancellor said what he said, here Milo forced himself to soldier on and not think about the previous week's debacle. I guess after that, he must have gone home and done some research, because yesterday he came in and said some nag-speak historian he knew had found something about a Chinese crew that came to the city much later, and Mr. Chancellor showed the whole class some written characters that I guess made up the name of the ship, and he asked me to translate them for everybody. His voice had gone shaky. And I didn't know them. So then he read the Mandarin pronunciation out loud and asked me to translate that. He gulped air. And I still didn't know. His father sighed. That is utter crap, Milo. I'm so sorry. It was three kinds of utter crap, if you wanted to get technical. In the first place, when Milo had raised his hand while they were discussing the War of 1812 to mention that Greenglass House, Lansdowne House, as it had been called then, had been built by a seafaring family with a Chinese child in it just before the war. Mr. Chancellor had said that, in fact, there hadn't been any Chinese crews to visit Nagspeak until much later in the century. Milo had started to explain that it hadn't been a Chinese crew. It had been a British and Chinese blended family called Blue Crown. But Mr. Chancellor had already moved on, as if he'd proved Milo wrong, and that was that. This had been the cause of last week's breakdown. Then yesterday had been crummy for two separate reasons. First, Mr. Chancellor had acted as though finding a Chinese crew arriving in Nagspeak in 1835 proved for sure that Milo was wrong about the Blue Crowns and their Chinese family members getting there earlier. That alone would have been untenable, because Milo wasn't wrong. Then the teacher had produced those characters and assumed Milo would be able to translate them just because he was Chinese, which had embarrassed him in front of his whole class. And that had been awful, not to mention unfair. It was unfair because Milo did know a number of characters. He and his parents had been learning together for a while now, only they were learning simplified Chinese characters. And from the looks of it, whatever writing system the ship's name had been composed in 200 years ago was vastly more complicated than what Milo was studying. It was doubly unfair because he and his parents were learning Mandarin too, but he wasn't a native speaker, in part because he'd grown up in Nagspeak, where the Chinese population still wasn't that big, and in part because he'd grown up with a mom and dad who not only weren't native speakers either, they were white. Plus, there were a ton of distinct dialects used in China. So even if Milo had been a native speaker, Mr. Chancellor still shouldn't have assumed he'd necessarily speak Mandarin. There was really no way to know whether even Milo's own birth family had spoken it. He and his parents had chosen Mandarin to learn because it had been easiest for Milo's school to find him a Mandarin tutor. And it was extra super really unfair because Milo was pretty sure there were plenty of actual Chinese people who wouldn't recognize every single Chinese character there was, and plenty who couldn't read them at all. But none of that was the truly awful part. The truly awful part was that all of these things taken together made Milo feel as if the phrase actual Chinese person didn't actually apply to him. Mr. Pine leaned his elbows on his knees. I'm guessing after that it didn't feel like you could explain to him why it was upsetting. No. After that, it had been all Milo could do not to burst into tears, and he'd gotten out of the classroom as fast as possible the minute it was time to go to lunch, where he'd worked hard to tamp down the panic attack he could feel coming on. He shook his head. I couldn't think of anything to say. Also, tears. Also, panic attack. I think I'd have felt the same way. His dad glanced at the dictionary and notebook on the floor. I guess that explains those. Getting some vocabulary work in? Yeah. They sat together for a moment, watching the twilight darken across the glittering lawn. In the living room behind them, the new wood crackled in the fireplace, and the smell tugged at Milo's heart. It's vacation, that smell said. It's almost Christmas. You can be happy. Just let yourself be happy. Mr. Pine put an arm around him, and Milo leaned into his shoulder. Hey, speaking of vocabulary, I have some new words I looked up this week. I need to double-check pronunciation, but here goes. Milo's dad held up his index finger. First, bridge. Either Chao or Chaolung. Although I think Chaolung might mean a metaphorical bridge. Second, broken, meaning falling apart. That's Zanpo. Then there's ferry, meaning the boat, which I think is Duchuan. Lastly, late. Wan. Milo grinned. So what you're telling me here is that you didn't make it on time to that meeting you were going to today? I did not, Mr. Pine confirmed. But let's focus on the fact that I can almost explain why in Mandarin. What have you got? Milo picked up his notebook. Winter is Dong Qian. A covering of snow is Ji Shue. Frost is Shuang. Annoying is Naoren. That's as far as I got. Mr. Pine chuckled. Tell me how you really feel. Then his expression sobered. Listen, you don't have to make a decision now, but I want you to think something over. It sounds to me like Mr. Chancellor thinks he's finding interesting things about the Chinese in Nagspeak, and he's just excited to share them. He doesn't realize how uncomfortable it makes you to be singled out. And he doesn't understand that he shouldn't make assumptions about you based on how you look. I think most people know they shouldn't make bad assumptions about people, but they don't always get that making any assumptions is probably not a good idea. And he probably knows you have a language tutor. Teachers do talk with each other. That could be why he thought you might know the Mandarin anyway. I guess. It might have been logical, but it wasn't precisely comforting. Milo could barely even deal with the idea of being talked about by people he loved and trusted, and Mr. Chancellor definitely fell outside that category. His dad made a sympathetic face. He knew. I think it's time your mom and I talk to him and just explain things. I bet you anything we can straighten it out. And then you won't have to worry anymore. He held out his right pinky. But we won't do it unless you say it's okay. Milo linked his pinky with his dad's. Pinky swears were unbreakable vows. If I say yes, you have to make them understand that I'm right about the Blue Crowns who built Greenglass House. Well, obviously, are you kidding? They shook their linked fingers. Now, maybe, if you can, try not to think about it anymore for a while. Because when you think about this kind of thing, you worry. And worrying just makes you feel worse. That much was true, even if it was easier to say you were going to stop worrying than to actually do it. I'll try. All right. We'll revisit this closer to New Year's. And in the meantime, if you want to talk more, you can come to Mom and me anytime. Deal? Deal. Great. And may I also compliment you on your choice of dinner menu? You may. Milo's dad got up and went off to do whatever parents did to keep themselves from bugging you when you plainly wanted space. And while Milo was trying to decide whether he felt better or not, the unthinkable happened. The bell rang. Chapter 2. The Bachelorette Party. Everybody froze. There was a distinct rattle of dishes in the kitchen, Mrs. Carraway had dropped something in shock. Milo turned slowly to look warily at his parents.
"Was that what I think it was?" Mrs. Pine asked.
The bell rang again. It had a slightly tinny, buzzing edge to its tone.
"I believe it was," Mr. Pine said, setting down the coffee he'd just brought to the dining table. "I guess I'd better go."
"Does that mean someone wants to come up?" Emmett asked.
"Not up," Milo's father said as he headed for the door. "That's not the rail car bell."
"I'll come too," Milo said, darting for his boots and coat. Greenglass House had two bells these days. There was the big old one that had hung on the porch almost since the house had been built, which was connected by a series of cords to a pole way down at the dock at the bottom of the hill. Usually, this was the bell that announced guests, since most of them arrived by boat. But there was a second, newer bell, one that Milo's father had put in only this year. It, too, was an antique, but it was electric, and instead of connecting to the dock, its lines ran up the hill and into the woods. It hadn't been used since the Pines had tested it back when it had first been installed. Milo and his father bundled up and marched out into the cold.
"You know what this means," Mr. Pine said thoughtfully.
"Yeah," Milo replied. "I wonder who's with him." They crossed the crunchy, frosty lawn and headed into the trees that covered the slope of the hill. All blue-green firs and bare, bone-colored birches, passing the assorted redstone outbuildings scattered throughout the woods until they came to the one that looked like a small, ramshackle house. In actuality, it was a train station. The doors were open, and a familiar, tall, thin figure stood in the entrance. Brandon Levy, the sole conductor on Nagspeak's all but defunct and mostly secret below-ground transit system.
"Oi, Ben. Hello, Milo," he said as they approached. "Bell worked, I take it?"
"Like a charm," Mr. Pine said, shaking Brandon's gloved hand. "Was this a test?"
"Nope. Got a couple of dubious characters looking for a place to lie low, wanted to make sure the coast was clear."
More guests, Milo sighed. And yet, he thought with a glimmer of excitement twitching to life in his gut, this is how it started last year. And last year had actually turned out to be more than just frustration and a bunch of changes to his beloved holiday routine. Last year, he had discovered Odd Trails, a role-playing game that had helped him find a more heroic version of himself in the form of a character called Negrit. Negrit was an escaladeur, a kind of blackjack or trickster who specialized in reconnaissance and stealth. A nimble, capable, less anxious Milo, yet not Milo, that he'd been able to turn to for a while when things got unpredictable or began to feel out of control. As Negrit, he had played a sort of real-world version of Odd Trails last year, a campaign waged within Greenglass House itself. And in the course of that campaign, he'd worked out the secrets that had brought 8 unexpected guests to his home. But all that had been because last year, among those strangers that had turned up, there had been one special stranger in particular. The one who had introduced him to Odd Trails and Negrit. He had waited and waited all year for her to turn up again, but she had never come back. Meddy. Meanwhile, Mr. Pine made a face. "We've got one guest, a skeleton enthusiast, a student of some kind, and I'd say he seems pretty non-threatening, for whatever that's worth. He's leaving day after tomorrow." He craned his neck to peer over Brandon's shoulder. "Who's with you? Anyone we know?"
"It's a surprise," Brandon said dryly.
He leaned back into the station.
"You guys catch all that? Want to chance it?"
"Like we have anywhere else to go, Brandon. Can we just go in? I'm freezing my tail off here." Milo hadn't heard those voices in a long time, but he knew them both right away. and he felt his face break into a wide smile. Milo's dad recognized them, too. "Come on out, the pair of you," he laughed. Brandon stood aside, and two women in their 20s burst out of the station. "Ta-da!" sang the one with a fringe of red curling out from under her black stocking cap. "Merry Christmas," said the other, who wore a black beret over bright blue hair. "With apologies for the lack of notice." Despite how little Milo relished the idea of more guests, these two were different. They'd been part of the bizarre and unexpected group of strangers who'd shown up last winter break, although back then they'd come as adversaries. Now, it seemed, they'd come as friends. "Hi, Clem. Hi, Georgie," Milo said, waving. "It's nice to see you."
"What's this waving stuff?" red-haired Clem Candler demanded. "Next you're going to try and shake hands. Get over here."
She wrapped him in a big hug.
"I'd hug you too," said blue-haired Georgie Moselle, "but I'm going to die of hypothermia if we don't get inside fast."
It was cold, but not that cold. Milo took a closer look at Georgie and realized she was practically swimming in a coverall suit that had to be made for somebody over 6 feet tall. Someone like Brandon, who, Milo realized, now that he was paying attention, wasn't wearing anything over his jeans and shirt and looked plenty cold, too.
"Is your hair wet?" Mr. Pine asked.
"And my shoes," Georgie grumbled. "And my clothes, which is why I'm drowning in Brandon's, for which I am extremely grateful," she added as they all started walking toward the house.
"Why is your hair wet?" Milo inquired.
"And what are you doing here?" Mr. Pine added. "Not that we aren't delighted to see you, obviously."
"Obviously," Clem said, grinning. Then her usual good humor faded. These two questions are not unrelated.
"We're on the lam," Georgie said grimly. "But if anyone asks, this is Clem's bachelorette weekend, and I'm treating her to a cozy winter getaway."
"Bachelorette weekend?"
Mr. Pine repeated dubiously. "Is this just a clever cover, or is there some truth to it?"
"The best covers always have some truth to them," Clem said.
"Yes, Owen and I are getting married just before New Year's. That is," her voice trailed off. "If I didn't just go and screw it all up beyond repair," Georgie finished. Clem touched her shoulder.
"I wasn't going to say that."
"I know you weren't. That's why I said it. But it's true."
"It's not true. And if I were going to say anything like that, I would have said, if I didn't just go and screw it up."
Milo glanced at his father. Mr. Pine caught his eye, winced, and glanced at Brandon, who put both hands up in a don't ask me gesture. They had reached the lawn. "Clearly there's more to this than we're going to have time to hear just now," Mr. Pine said. "Like I was telling Brandon, I'm pretty sure the guy at the house is, as advertised, just a fellow who's way into windows. But he's staying until day after tomorrow, so for the moment, what do we call you?" Georgie and Clem glanced at each other.
"Real names are fine," Georgie said.
"Aliases aren't going to help us out of this one. They know who we are and what we look like."
Before anyone could ask what that ominous comment was all about, Mrs. Pine opened the front door. Georgie and Clem shouted hellos and took off at a trot for the warmth of the indoors. Then, just as everyone was crowding up the stairs, there was the sound of car tires on gravel behind them, and Lizzie Caraway honked and leaned out the window of her battered blue car. Apparently, it was going to be a full house for a while. Milo couldn't decide if he was about to freak out or not.
"Come on, Meddy," he begged silently. "Where are you?"
After a quick flurry of hellos and hugs, with introductions for Emmett Seibuck's benefit,
Mrs. Pine took Georgie's plastic bag full of wet clothes to throw in the dryer, and Milo led her and Clem upstairs to the guest rooms. Neither had much in the way of luggage. Clem had a smallish backpack and a short document tube, and Georgie had a messenger satchel. Halfway up the stairs, Milo remembered his manners. "Want me to take those?"
"Thanks, Milo, but there's glass in mine again," Georgie said with a half smile.
Milo blushed. Last year, he'd smashed a bottle of perfume while helping with Georgie's luggage.
"I'm fine," Clem said. "Thanks anyway."
"Okay, any preference?" he asked as they reached the third floor landing.
"Where's the civilian?" Georgie asked.
"This floor, 3E.
"Let's go up to 5, Clem said tiredly.
"So you can get your runs in again?"
Milo asked.
When she'd been a guest here last year, Clem had spent a lot of time running the stairs.
But she shook her head. "Just looking for privacy, I don't know if I'm going to feel much like running."
Milo frowned. This was totally unlike the Clem Candler he knew. They trooped up to the 5th floor, above which there was nothing but attic. Clem chose 5W, the same room she'd picked last year, and Georgie took the one next to it. Just as they were about to close their respective doors, footsteps drummed in the stairwell, and Emmett Sybuck appeared from around the corner with his camera bouncing against his hip.
"Wait," he huffed.
Both Clem and Georgie leaned warily out into the hall, still holding their bags.
"Can I just... there are 2 windows on this floor I haven't sketched yet. Can I take some pictures before you settle in?"
The 2 girls looked at each other, then, with similar curious expressions, considered the art student still trying to get his wind back.
"Which ones do you still need to get?" Milo asked.
Emmett took one last deep breath and pointed at Clem's room.
"The enameled windows in there, right? I need that one. And the one in 5E, I think?"
Clem stepped aside and waved an arm.
"Go for it. I picked a different room anyway. I was just having a look at the enameled glass myself."
"Oh, thanks." Emmett glanced at Georgie. "What about you? Will I be in your way if I take some pictures?"
"Nope," Georgie replied breezily. "We're both staying on 4, but Milo said we shouldn't miss the windows up here." And without waiting to hear his reply, they headed back downstairs again. Emmett watched them go, looking a little confused.
"Guess you don't have to rush after all," Milo said.
"Yeah," Emmett agreed. "It's pretty dark already, anyway. Still, as long as I'm up here." He shrugged and disappeared into 5W. Milo descended to the 4th floor and walked down the hall until he heard movement in one of the rooms. He knocked on the door of 4W.
"What was that all about?" he asked when Georgie peered out.
"Job-related instincts," she said as the door to the adjacent room opened and Clem came out to join them.
"Probably unnecessary, but just in case." She glanced at Clem. "What do you think?"
"About young Mr. Sybuck?"
Clem considered, then gave Milo a gentle push into 4W. She followed him and closed the door behind her. She looked at Milo, then around him, as if there might be someone else in the room. Milo turned to see if somebody had somehow managed to follow him without his noticing.
"Is it just you, Milo?" she asked.
"Oh," Milo slumped.
"Yeah, it's just me."
"Too bad. It would have been useful to have extra eyes and ears on things right about now." Clem perched on the desk and clapped her hands on her knees.
"So, Sybuck. I don't get any particular vibe from him."
She glanced at Georgie, who sat cross-legged on the bed, still engulfed in Brandon's coveralls.
"You?"
Georgie made a non-committal noise.
"What else do you know about him, Milo?"
"Not much. He's a student at City University, and he's been sketching and photographing everything glass in the house. He's nice enough, super enthusiastic. If he's at the university, then Gowervine would know him, right? Clem asked. I mean, since he studies glass and whatnot, how many stained glass nerds could there be at one institution? I'll try to get a hold of the professor, Georgie said. I'll feel a lot better if we can verify that this guy is who he says he is. Clem nodded. She stood and started to pace. Milo looked from one to the other. They both seemed so troubled. Georgie was clearly worried, and Clem looked concerned too, but mainly she seemed sad. Sadness looked totally wrong on her face. What's going on? He asked. The two girls hesitated. Don't you trust me? Milo demanded, indignant. Of course we do, Milo. Clem sighed. It's just that, well, you know what we do for a living. Yes, Milo said slowly. And that it's not always legal, strictly speaking. You're thieves, Milo said pointedly. When is that ever legal? The point is, we don't want to get you in trouble, or your parents either. We just need a place to hide out for a while, and the less you know, the better. Isn't that how it usually works around here? Usually, Milo admitted. Greenglass House's clientele was, to be accurate, mostly made up of smugglers. Generally, smugglers on shore leave, but every once in a while, there were guests who the Pines suspected were not so much on vacation as hiding out. Everybody involved knew not to ask questions. Milo knew it, and yet, Clem and Georgie were their friends, and they were obviously in trouble. If there's anything we can do to help, Mom and Dad would want to know about it, Milo said. Me too. I know, Milo, Clem said, ruffling his hair. She looked to Georgie. And Milo did figure pretty much everything out last time we were here. Nobody would have found what they were looking for if not for him. That's the truth, Georgie admitted. Let me think about it. She looked at Milo for a long minute. Milo, where's Meddy these days? I don't know, Milo said, his frustration about his friend's absence bubbling right up to the surface. I haven't seen her since Christmas Eve. But is she here? Georgie persisted. Milo shook his head. If she is, she isn't showing herself. I don't know why. But if she isn't here, maybe that means Emmett Sybuck is who he says he is. Last year, she said she felt a wrongness in the house once the guests started showing up, and that's part of what brought her to us. Ghosts, Clem said, shaking her head. Who can figure them? True enough. Chapter 3. To Clem and Georgie. Milo left Georgie and Clem to settle in, whatever that meant to a pair of nervous thieves without any actual luggage to unpack, and went down to the second floor, which was his family's private living space. There, in his parents' study, he found the keys to 4W and 4S, which he delivered to Georgie's room, where the two women were still camped out, talking in hushed voices that went silent the moment he knocked. Thanks, Clem said, whisking the keys out of his palm. She started to close the door, then sighed and looked back at Georgie. I'd better just do it, hadn't I? Unless you want me to, Georgie said listlessly. Mea culpa and so forth. No, the longer I don't call, the weirder it'll seem. Clem turned to Milo. Think I could use your phone? Milo looked at the phone on the table next to Georgie's bed. Well, yeah, of course. No, she said apologetically. I mean, your family's private phone? Just since we know that Saiba character wanders the guest floors. Should I ask your mom and dad? No, that's okay. They won't mind. I'll show you. He led Clem down to the second floor. This, at least, was familiar. If he hadn't known Clem was there, Milo would never have guessed he was being followed. She was utterly soundless as she walked, like a cat. Hey, Clem, he asked. Think while you're here you can show me how to use the lockpicks you gave me last year? Sure, Milo, she said, sounding preoccupied. Hey, would you do me a favor, too? Would you be a lookout for me while I make this call, just in case? Sure. Milo opened the study door and pointed to the phone on the drop front desk. I'll be right outside. Clem slipped in and closed the door. Milo sat cross-legged outside the study. A moment later, on the other side of the wall, Clem began speaking. It sounded as if she was leaving a message for Dr. Gowervine. There were no pauses for anyone else to reply. Then came a brief silence. When Clem spoke again, it was in a completely different tone of voice. Hey, love, just want to let you know where I am. It had to be Owen on the other end of the line now. There was a pause. I know, but Georgie arranged a weekend away as a surprise. I would have called earlier, but I assumed you were in on it. Silence for a moment. Then Clem spoke again. That's not fair. I said I would, didn't I? Silence. We'll be back Monday. Pause. A short laugh. Then, Greenglass House, of course. After that came the I love you goodbye business. Milo stared hard at the ceiling and tried not to listen to anything other than the creaks of the house. Finally, Clem emerged, closed the door behind her, and dropped to a seat next to Milo. She sat in silence for a minute, then she rolled her head against the wall to look his way. Never lie to the people you love, Milo. It's so crummy and it takes so much energy. Okay, Milo said helplessly. Everything's all right? For the moment, she smiled weakly and got to her feet. Thanks. Then she left, soundlessly as ever. Since the inn now had three guests to feed, plus Brandon, who volunteered to stay for dinner if no one minded, Lizzie headed back into town for groceries. She and her mother had offered to stay the night to help prep meals for the next day. By the time she got back, and they all sat down to eat, it was nearly 7, which wasn't that much past their usual dinner time, but after all the comings and goings and the early nightfall, it felt a lot later to Milo. The table was full. Milo and his parents, Mrs. Carraway and Lizzie, Brandon and Emmett and Clem and Georgie, who was looking a bit more comfortable now that she had her own dry clothes back. And although both girls were still acting not quite like themselves, it was a fairly companionable meal. Plus, Mrs. Carraway was getting really good at the stir-fried tomatoes and eggs. Milo had 2 helpings. I hear we have a cause for celebration, Lizzie said, throwing an arm around Clem's shoulders. Yes, it's true, Clem said, putting on a wide but definitely forced smile. Owen and I are getting married right before the new year. I picked up some champagne in town, Lizzie told her. We can have a toast tonight. That's super, Lizzie, thanks. You know, they got together right here, Brandon said to Emmett, last year at Christmas. Sure did, Clem said. That's why Georgie decided to bring me back to Greenglass House for a getaway before Owen and I tie the knot. I was wondering, Emmett said. Seems a little low-key for a bachelorette party. I'm a low-key sort of girl, Clem told him. Oh, then you must have met Dr. Gowervine, the art student went on. He glanced at Mrs. Pine. Wasn't it last Christmas that he was here? Milo looked up at his parents. Nobody had confirmed that. Fortunately, the Pines had their answers worked out already. Probably had since the day Emmett had turned up on their doorstep. I'm sure you can understand that we don't talk about our guests to anyone else, Mrs. Pine said smoothly. Privacy. Emmett nodded, chastened. Of course. So what brings you here, Mr. Sybuck? Georgie asked. Milo thought there was a bit of an inquisitorial edge to her voice, but if so, it went right over Emmett's head. Instantly, his embarrassment melted away, and the brightness of the smile he turned on Georgie was enough to make her sit back in her seat a little. Are you kidding? This place is a work of art. He pointed to the chandelier over the table, a sort of minimalist imagining of a ship with curling triangular pieces of frosted glass for sails. An actual work of Skellinson glass, just hanging up in an inn. It's like being invited to someone's place for Thanksgiving and discovering they live in a Frank Lloyd Wright house. Or going for a sail with a friend and his boat's an original Clinkerville clipper. He sighed happily. It's extraordinary, not to mention all the other glass. 18th century pieces in the stairwells? The enameled window on the fifth floor. Do you know, I think that's a Wells Howe window. As far as I'm aware, there are no other Wells Howe windows in Nagspeak that aren't in museums. And she painted them in situ, to be complemented by the particular light in that location at a particular time, on a particular day of the year. If this is the original home of that piece, it's an unprecedented opportunity to see the window as the artist truly intended it to be seen. Plus, he added, turning to Milo's folks, it would mean that Ella Mae Wells Howe was once literally here, actually in your home. He looked around the table, radiating delight. That's really something, Clem replied, amused. Was all Georgie said. And I don't know which rooms you picked on the fourth floor, Emmett continued, but I've been obsessing over one of the windows up there. It's a smallish window, copper foil holding the pieces, and it has four round medallions with images of people in them. It looks like gilded glass. He scratched his head thoughtfully. Maybe some artist's take on verre eglomise? It might even be very thin gold sandwich glass, although ordinarily it's not hard to tell the difference. Abruptly, he seemed to remember he'd been talking to other people and glanced expectantly from Georgie to Clem and back. You know the one? I think that's in my room, Georgie said warily. He grinned. Lucky. Also, I wish you would call me Emmett. Everybody, I mean, he added hastily. I'll try, Georgie said dryly. She stood and picked up her plate. Anybody else done? I'll clear the table. Milo handed his plate over and turned to his mom. May I be excused? Sure, pal. He ran up to his room and rifled through his desk for a spiral pad and pen he'd found in the attic a year ago. He slipped these in one of his back pockets, and in the other, he tucked a rolled cylinder of leather tied closed with a cord. His lockpick kit. Then he dashed back down the stairs and into the living room and crawled into the space between the tree and the corner in which it sat beside the crackling fire. It was a spot that he looked forward to making his own every year, and usually it was a place he loved for its privacy. This year, though, it felt a little lonely. He opened the pad and looked at a blank page for a long time. Then he closed it again and sat back against the wall, letting his eyes go out of focus as he stared into the tree so that it became a blur of twinkles and gleams against a deep green canvas. There was something going on with Clem and Georgie for sure, but that wasn't so much a puzzle to crack as a thing they hadn't chosen to share. Somehow, it didn't seem right to try to uncover the secrets of his friends, especially since, whatever was up, Clem hadn't even told her fiancé about it. "Another half hour to cake," Mrs. Carraway announced in the dining room. "Shall I open the champagne? Who'd like a glass?" Emmett was the only one to decline. "No need for me to be an interloper for your toast. Plus, there's an outrageous moon out there. Maybe I'll go check out that fifth floor window again and see how it looks in moonlight." A few minutes later, Mr. Pine sat down at the edge of the hearth and passed Milo a tumbler of reddish punch with a cherry on a little silver toothpick in it. "Fancy," Milo said. "Thank you." "You're welcome. You have to have something for the toast. Come on." Milo took his punch and followed Mr. Pine back to the dining room, where Lizzie popped the cork from a fat green bottle and poured champagne into seven low saucer-shaped glasses. When everyone had been served, Mrs. Pine lifted her glass. "There will be so many toasts to the bride and groom-to-be that I don't think the world will miss one if I change things up." She looked at Georgie and Clem, who each stood with her non-champagne-holding arm around the other. "Let's make this a toast to these two young ladies, who first came here as rivals but returned as true friends." As Mrs. Pine spoke, Georgie's face fell. But Clem's, which had been pulled tight into an expression approximating happiness, relaxed into something real. For an instant, true happiness shone through. And it was in that moment that Georgie happened to glance at her friend. What she saw there made her own pained expression melt away too. And for a brief spell, the room was full of actual, unfeigned gladness. Milo lifted his punch cup. "To Clem and Georgie." "To Clem and Georgie," everyone else echoed. They clinked glasses all around. Mrs. Pine came around to Milo and his dad. She linked her arm through Mr. Pine's and gave Milo a gentle nudge with the hand holding her glass. "Come on, you two." She led them away from the others and into the living room, and the three of them sat on the hearth. "While we have a moment's peace, Merry almost Christmas, guys. Happy first day of vacation." They clinked glasses again. Then someone cleared her throat, and the momentary peace splintered just like that. "I'm so sorry to interrupt," said Georgie. Clem stood a few paces behind her. "But while Emmett's up there paying homage to the Wells How, we thought we'd better fill you in, since who knows when we might get another chance." Mrs. Pine shook her head. "You don't have to tell us anything." "I know," Georgie said. "And we thought at first that probably you'd rather we didn't. But we think you should have the whole story, in case, once you do, you'd rather we didn't stay. I'm not sure where else we'd go and feel as safe as we feel here, but we certainly have other options, and we would never in a million years want to put you in an awkward position." "I can't imagine," Mr. Pine began. Georgie held up a hand. I get it, but maybe since we aren't sure how much privacy we'll have, we should just lay our cards on the table. She glanced over her shoulder to where Brandon was leaning on the back of the love seat with his arms crossed. From there, he'd have a clear view all the way across the dining room to the stairs. "Brandon already knows. We told him on the below ground. He'll warn us if Cybuck comes back." "Okay," Mrs. Pine glanced briefly at Milo. "Would you rather talk on the screened porch?" Meaning, Milo guessed, would you rather Milo doesn't hear? He gave her a sour look, got up, and climbed into the space behind the tree. His mom made an apologetic face in his direction. "I think it might look less suspicious if we're all in here," Clem said with a wink at Milo. His dad nodded. All right, then. What's the story?
Georgie sat on the floor with her back against the coffee table and her knees drawn up to her chest, and rubbed her face hard with both hands. I guess the summary is, I'm an idiot, and this whole thing is my fault, but basically, Clem and I did our first and possibly only job together, and it went very, very wrong.
Chapter 4. The Heist. A job? Mrs. Pine repeated cautiously.
A job, Georgie confirmed. The kind of job at which Clem and I are consummate professionals. That kind of job.
Understood.
Define very, very wrong, Mr. Pine suggested. As in, you failed to complete the work involved in this job? Didn't leave with a paycheck or whatever?
Over by the love seat, Brandon snorted.
What am I standing lookout for if you're going to dance around everything? Worried Lizzie and Mrs. C are going to squeal.
He leaned toward the kitchen.
You too going to squeal?
Yes,
came Lizzie's disembodied voice.
Absolutely,
Mrs. Caraway replied. Mr. Pine rolled his eyes.
So you didn't manage to take whatever it was?
Oh, we definitely did, Clem told him, dropping onto the couch. Walked away with the entire haul.
Then what's the problem?
There are two. Georgie held up her thumb. One, we had to involve a third person. And we strongly suspect this third person tried, maybe hasn't finished trying, to double-cross us. Two, she held up her pointer finger. We think we weren't the only ones after the haul, and it's possible the other thief isn't going to give up on it just because we stole it first.
So two people are potentially after you. Who's the double-crosser?
Mrs. Pine asked. Anybody we know? Not that we keep company with double-crossers, generally, or thieves, present company excepted.
Actually, you might have heard of him, Georgie admitted. He's primarily a fence,
guy who acts as a middleman for moving stolen or illegal goods, she said to Milo.
I know what a fence is, he said grouchily.
Sorry. Anyway, his name's Galoffer. Toby Galoffer? Milo's parents looked at each other.
Isn't that the guy Fenster was so mad at this fall?
Mrs. Pine asked her husband. The thing with the flooded warehouse where he lost all those really rare plants?
That's him, Clem confirmed. Poor Fenster. I'm sorry to hear he lost cargo, but that flood gave us the clue we needed to find the cash we were after.
To be fair to the jerk, the flood wasn't his fault, Georgie said grudgingly. Galoffer's warehouse was damaged by a much older structure buried right underneath it. There's lots of that kind of stuff in the quayside harbors. Old, weird iron constructions hidden underground. Nobody knows much about them, but if you believe the stories, they're constantly shifting around. Something to do with erosion on the riverbank, maybe? Or just one of those oddball, unexplainable things? Who knows? But I guess there's some truth to it, because Galoffer had no idea there was anything under his foundations until these huge pieces of iron started working their way up from beneath his floor, and a ton of river water rushed in through the places the iron breached.
Meanwhile, we were after this particular score, Clem explained. All our information seemed to hint that it had been stashed in a subterranean hidey hole somewhere on the skid rack, just outside the quayside harbors. But we weren't making any headway on finding the right spot until Galoffer's flood happened.
And you realized that older building beneath Galoffer's warehouse must have been the hidey hole you were looking for, Mrs. Pine guessed.
Georgie nodded. But there was no way in except through the warehouse, and idiots that we were, we decided to offer him a piece of the hall in exchange for access to the structure below it. Long story short, he agreed. We went in, and the main score, the point of the whole job, the one thing that mattered, it just wasn't there. We assumed Galoffer had hoodwinked us somehow, Clem said. He was the only other person who knew there might be anything of value under his warehouse, but we hadn't told him exactly what we expected to find. The reason we hadn't told him, by the way, Georgie put in, was that we had no intention of sharing that main thing. We'd have given him anything else in the cache, everything else even, but not that. So yeah, our initial thought was that somehow he found out and got his hooks on it first. But then, when he saw what we did find, he demanded we hand over the big thing, the thing that clearly wasn't there. So he did already know about it. And he was planning to cheat us, but he was as surprised as we were that it wasn't there. And he doesn't believe us that we don't have it, which hardly matters when you consider that we weren't going to give it to him anyway. But that's not the point, Clem sniffed. We aren't liars. Or, well, she glanced at Milo, probably remembering their earlier conversation. I mean, sometimes we are, but we weren't lying about that. And then there's the other guy. Georgie glanced at Brandon, who shook his head. No Psybuck yet. She leaned back against the coffee table. Remember last year I told you about how Clem and I first got to know each other? Milo spoke up. You were both trying to steal the same thing. Someone's heart, he thought, but didn't say. Owen's heart. The same Owen who'd turned out to have been in love with Clem all along, and who Clem had been speaking to upstairs in the study. Right. A little flash of emotion appeared in Georgie's eyes and faded away again just as quickly. And remember, I said it was virtually impossible for two elite thieves to make a play for the same prize without finding out about each other? Well, Clem and I quickly became aware of another thief at work. We suspect we were being watched from the moment we approached Galoffer, and that the other guy decided to sit back, wait until we had the loot, and then come after us. And we aren't sure, but we think we know who it is. And if we're right, then we have a huge problem, Clem added. There's a master thief called Cantlebone, who sometimes turns up in Nagspeak, though you hear stories about incredible heists in other places that people think are his work. She threw up her hands. Or hers, we don't know. Nobody knows who Cantlebone is or what Cantlebone looks like. It's a weird thing when you suddenly think your personal hero might be out to get you, Georgie muttered. So that's why all this concern about Emmett, Mr. Pine said. Clem shrugged. He's the only unknown quantity here. He certainly could be Cantlebone. But he's been here for a week, Milo put in. If you can tell me he's never left the house in that time, I might feel better, Georgie said. But even then, I don't know if it matters. We don't know if Cantlebone works alone or with a crew. Milo's mom shook her head. He's been in and out, library trips and research, supposedly, mostly by boat by way of the harbors. When was your job? Yesterday, Georgie said. Although today's been fairly eventful too, frankly. Hence my turning up looking like a drowned rat. A small matter of a bridge that had to be sacrificed in the name of a good escape. Mr. Pine chuckled. So you're who I have to thank for the change in my commute today. Probably, Georgie admitted. Sorry. Milo's parents looked at each other. Psybuck was definitely out of the house all day yesterday, and for a decent chunk of the afternoon today, Mr. Pine said. We shared a boat across at about midday, and he didn't come back until a little after Milo got home from school. Not to mention he was supposed to leave tomorrow, but this afternoon he asked to extend his stay through Sunday, Mrs. Pine added. So we definitely can't rule him out, Georgie muttered. Milo raised his hand to ask the obvious question. What were you looking for? What's the big thing? At this, both Georgie and Clem cracked real smiles at last. Another glance at Brandon, who gave a bored, all clear. Then Georgie said slowly, dramatically, Have you ever heard of a Darrow-Tarrow? Darrow-Tarrow? Milo repeated. He shook his head. He looked to his mother, whose face was blank. I don't think I know that word, she said. Mr. Pine scratched his head. Huh, you know, I think I do know it. He stared at the fire for a minute. It's an atlas or something, right? A book of charts? Essentially, Clem confirmed, but very secret charts. Back in the age of exploration, European navigators would map the various bits of terra incognita they encountered. Coastlines in particular. They'd collect the charts and books, and because geographic knowledge was power in those days, these books were carefully guarded. Spanish mariners called them Darrow-Tarrows. Now think about our own waterways, Georgie put in. The skid rack is notoriously difficult to map. Even people who know it well generally only know parts of it. And everybody who works on the river talks about how untrustworthy the available maps are. That's true, Mr. Pine agreed. My father used to gripe about that all the time. Or he'd gripe about green navigators who trusted the maps too much and wound up running their vessels onto shoals that weren't marked. Or who insisted there wasn't a channel or even an entire inlet where everyone else knew there was one just because it wasn't on his chart. Right. So now imagine a Darrow-Tarrow of the skid rack. A truly accurate collection of charts of the river and all the inlets. Georgie's eyes glittered. Can you imagine what a book like that would be worth? Yeah, Mr. Pine said a little warily. Smugglers would die for a resource like that. The customs department or the folks from Deacon and Morvengard would kill for it. But is such a thing even possible? Mrs. Pine asked. I thought it was sort of accepted that the skid rack shifts too much for any map to stay accurate for long, and that's why the city had more or less given up on charting it. And people have claimed to have true charts before, you know, Mr. Pine added. They always turn out to be frauds. The two thieves said nothing, but the glint in Georgie's eyes got even brighter. Yet you clearly already know that. Milo's dad said suspiciously. What else do you know that makes this different from any of those times? What makes it different, Georgie said with the teensiest hint of a smirk, is whose Darrow-Tarrow it was. She looked at each of them in turn, Mrs. Pine, Mr. Pine, Milo. It belonged, she said at last, lifting her champagne in a salute, to Violet Cross. She took a sip, waggling her eyebrows over the rim of the glass. Milo's father's jaw literally dropped. You're kidding, Mrs. Pine said, aghast. Georgie shook her head. Not in the slightest. Milo sat back in his space under the tree and considered. He knew the name, of course. Violet Cross was one of Nagsbeak's most famous smugglers, maybe the greatest runner the city had ever seen. In a relatively short time, she'd built one of the most impressive careers in city history, running circles around both the customs agency and the mail order empire Deacon and Morvengard, which most of Nagsbeak believed, with plenty of justification, essentially ran customs as its own private enforcement division. Violet Cross was a true legend. Okay, Mrs. Pine said. I think, well, I don't know what I think, except wow.
So you're telling us you two found a stash belonging to Violet Cross? Mr. Pine's voice dropped nearly to a whisper at the end.
Hand to God, Clem said.
Well, Georgie found it. It would have been the heist of a lifetime for anybody else. For Georgie, this was a weekend project. I mean, I'm good, and I have no problem saying so, but this was next level. I basically just tagged along.
Quit flattering me, Georgie grumbled. I couldn't have pulled it off without you. Not to mention, it was only potentially next level until it went wrong.
Not your fault, Clem argued. Jobs go wrong all the time. It's an occupational hazard.
Georgie ignored this and addressed the Pines.
If you're wondering why I'm taking it so personally that things went awry, the reason is this. The job was supposed to be a wedding present for Clem. It was our first job together, and it was going to be a last hurrah for her, a truly epic score before...
Clem finished the sentence a bit sourly.
Before I give it up for good.
She drained what was left of her champagne and stared grimly into the empty glass.
Is there more?
Now they all looked at her, all except Georgie, who got up, left the room, and returned with an unopened bottle. She peeled away the foil at the top and popped the cork with as little noise as she could manage.
You're going straight? Milo asked, shocked. Why?
Clem sighed.
Because, Milo, I fell in love, which, in retrospect, I'm not sure I recommend.
She held out her glass for Georgie to refill.
Or at least, thieves shouldn't fall in love with anyone who's not also a crook.
You're quitting for Owen?
Now Milo felt a little indignant. Is he making you? Why does he want you to be somebody else?
No, Milo, it's not like that. Clem shook her head. He only asked me to give it up until after the honeymoon. And that's how I look at it. Giving something up. Like giving up candy or smoking or cursing. I don't think it means changing who I am. I'm not only a thief. I'm lots of other things, too.
Georgie silently refilled her own glass. Judging from her expression, she didn't totally agree with Clem's interpretation of the situation.
I figure law-abiding citizens generally would rather their spouses weren't going out at night to commit crimes, Clem continued quietly. And I don't want it to come to Owen asking me to quit for good. That would
make me angry.
So you decided to preempt his asking, Milo's mom said sadly. All right. I see why this job was so important to you both.
Brandon coughed a low, deliberate cough. Then he straightened and sauntered into the dining room. Emmett was coming down.
Now you know the whole thing, Clem said quickly, getting to her feet. If you'd rather we leave, we'll understand. Brandon offered to run us back into town or out to the end of the line if we want.
Mrs. Pine rolled her eyes.
Don't be ridiculous, Clem. I appreciate your honesty, but stay.
She stood, squeezed Georgie's arm, rubbed Clem's shoulder, and headed for the kitchen.
Really? Georgie said to Milo's father. You sure?
Absolutely, he said without hesitation. Drink your champagne.
Emmett bounded into the living room.
What's everybody looking so glum for?
I saw Mrs. Caraway cutting the cake. He smiled at Georgie. Can I get a piece for you?
Sure, Georgie said suspiciously. Thanks.
Welcome. Out he went again, grinning like an idiot.
There is definitely something weird about that guy, Georgie said, watching him leave the room through narrowed eyes.
Then she turned back to Milo.
What do you say?
We almost ruined your Christmas last year.
Milo shook his head. No, you didn't. Not really.
Okay, in that case, I guess we'll stick around for a bit.
Thank you.
She glanced down at her hands.
I'm gonna need something to keep me busy, though.
She thought for a minute, reached into her pocket, and pulled out a coin. Then she turned to Milo's dad.
Do you by chance have a Dremel tool?
Or no, I can do it with sandpaper.
Do you have sandpaper?
Really fine grain would be best.
Probably, Mr. Pine said, looking at the coin warily.
Excellent. Could I have a piece?
A whole sheet, ideally.
In the meantime, I'll help pass out cake.
Then she, too, left the living room. Clem dropped onto the hearth.
Milo, why don't you go get those lockpicks now? I need something to take my mind off things, too.
What about Emmett?
Milo whispered.
She shrugged and lowered her voice.
If he's anyone to worry about, he already knows what I am. If he's not, who cares? Thieves aren't the only ones who need to know how to open locks.
Also, Georgie's about to attack a coin with a piece of sandpaper. Who's going to care what we're up to?
She winked. But if he asks, you found the picks in your attic.
Milo climbed out from behind the tree, took the rolled cylinder from his back pocket, and sat next to her.
I was hoping you'd say something like that.
Clem whistled. Way to be ready.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.